We have Coach Timo Scheunemann with us to talk about the tragedy. Hello, Coach Timo. Thank you so much for joining us back in the program. So, first of all, can you give us like an overall view from you about this tragedy?
Yeah, it's so unfortunate, yeah. But more than the fact that so many people died, it's even more unfortunate because it has happened before. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there is such thing as prevention and care. And we know that as we take care of our health, we know that when we study physical fitness, there's always prevention and care. And so in the prevention, there must have been something that went wrong, because this is not the first time. So they have enough examples in the past, and they have guidelines from FIFA, yes, including not using tear gas. So the prevention was not right. But then the wind shift, so to speak, it wasn't the police that started it, obviously. And so the people, the fans, came in, and it just became this tragedy because now the police had to act, obviously had to act, but then used, unfortunately, tear gas. And because they used tear gas in a stadium, there's a reason why tear gas isn't allowed in a stadium setting. It might be used for normal setting in the inner city. So for normal situations or for specific situation, yes, probably, but not in the stadium for this reason, so that a stampede will not happen. And that's why the article, what is it, the 16, I believe, or 19 in the FIFA regulations about security talks about not using tear gas. So the prevention was lacking. And then the supporters obviously have to learn to accept defeat, right? This is a nationwide problem, right? This is a problem that has been going on for decades. I've been born here, and since I played, it's the same way. Mm-hmm. So the supporters really need to change on this. And then the wind shift again, see, to the police again, because they had to obviously do something about it, but they chose the wrong care. So the prevention was lacking, even though there were enough examples in the past, even though one can suspect Arema against Persebaya will be trouble. There was a problem, obviously, with the prevention, not enough. But you know what, in life, sometimes the best prevention still isn't enough, right? Mm.
Yeah.
So, you know, we do exercises, for example, we eat well and stuff like that, and yet we get sick, for example, right? Mm-hmm. And so obviously you gotta be good at care as well, not just at prevention. So the care part wasn't done right. It's very, very unfortunate that they use tear gas. That's the main problem I see in this incident. Now the police obviously now are trying to paint a picture that is the whole picture, right? And mm-hmm. and in this whole picture you can see that there's so many different parts of people, different sides, you know, different stakeholders,
yeah,
that have their part in this tragedy, because the police wanted to push the game into the afternoon instead of playing it in the evening for security reasons, mm-hmm. right? I don't know if this would have made a difference, but the point is still, be it as it may, right? Everybody has to do some introspection, and from the police, obviously, the usage of tear gas is simply unacceptable.
felt cautious.
And that's a big problem because right there is because we could get trouble with FIFA for that reason, because FIFA is explicit in that rule. So we went against a FIFA rule, right? So I'm really hoping we're not getting banned, obviously. Maybe, I don't know, maybe it's good, maybe it's, I don't know. I don't wanna take side on that. But the point is, Indonesian football right now with Piala Dunia under 20, you know, World Cup under 20 coming up in Indonesia, such an honor to hold that. And we have a good team, and the senior team is doing good right now. So it's just so unfortunate on so many different levels.
Koshimo, I wanted to ask you one thing, because yes, the code 19 was so important, but because it explicitly says no gas of any kind or any sharp objects or any weapons were to be carried by policemen and, you know, stewards of the, you know, of the area. And the interesting part is this is a law broken. According to precedents, what are the things that can happen to Indonesia right now? Because there will be a sanction, but who has the right to sanction what? Because I understand this is not an international game. This is still a club game at a national level. And usually there are different levels, you know, levels of standards of hold and levels of governance. What kind of sanctions should FIFA give a sanction to Indonesia? Could be possible to be given.
I'm not sure that's a big question right now, whether we get sanctions at all. And then if we do, what kind of sanction would we get? But that's obviously in the mind of everybody who are stakeholders in Indonesian football, you know. But if we look at, for example, Egypt in 2012, has had an incident where people got killed in the stadium, way less than ours. And what happened there was FIFA did not ban them or anything like that, but the sports minister actually stepped in, and FIFA was fine with that. So you know, if now the government steps in and does something, and then the federation says, oh, wait a minute, you're going against FIFA statutes, like they have said in the past. That's not what happened in Egypt. In Egypt, the sports minister said enough is enough. Egypt League without the supporters. And they did that for 2 years. Mm-hmm. And then after 2 years, the supporters were allowed back in. And another killing between supporters took place in the stadium. 22 people died the second time around, and then it was banned for another 4 years, I believe. So, but again, that was internally done by the government of Egypt to the federation. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't done by FIFA. So big question if FIFA is going to do anything at all. But at the same time, there is huge pressure on FIFA, because this is obviously a big, big incident, you know, and I hate that. I hate that when people say it's a small incident or big incident. One life is already too many. One life is too many for what? For watching football.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
oh, yes.
It's true.
It's just so sad, you know.
Right, Coach Timo, can we please go back to talking about the root cause of this incident? You've mentioned earlier a little bit about the nature of football here in Indonesia. We know that soccer violence has long been a problem here in Indonesia. And obviously, you were born here. You know everything about Indonesian football. Could you please help us understand, how did it become this way? How was the culture shaped in this country? And what are the things that we have to do to change this?
Well, some things are obvious. You know, kids follow the footsteps of their parents, of their uncles, or, you know, their aunties. And what they see is what they do, right? And so if kids are going to the stadiums and their chants, dibunuh saja, kita harus menang. You know, not kita bisa menang hari ini. Not we can win today, but we have to win today. Or let's kill them. Let's kill them. You know, using words like that. Or when someone's on the pitch and getting injured, and then they they chant La ilaha illallah or something, like someone's dead, you know. Mm-hmm. We can start there. I mean, obviously, that's just really bad example to the next generation, right?
Right.
So, and then maybe looking back at the Indonesian history of football, there was something called Perserikatan before, mm-hmm. which is why Indonesian football clubs have so many per, you know, mm-hmm. Persisolo, Persebaya, yeah. and all that stuff, because, you know, Persatuan, right? And that kind of fueled kedaerahan, right? Mm-hmm. Something like, this is the pride, just like, you know, there is a pride of Indonesians, you know, like that we feel as a nation. There's also pride of a city or a region, you know, and that pride in the past has been a big time important to the, especially regions like Medan, Surabaya, you mm-hmm. know, Semarang, places where, you know, Bandung, places where football is really almost a religion, you know.
Yeah.
And so in places like that, obviously, now things have changed. The football is no longer Perserikatan, right? No longer amateur or done by the different, you know, regional heads of government. Now it has become privatized, and players come from all over, not just from their own region, but, you know, you have that legacy still, because that, you know, the root problem is, you know, when you say eye for an eye, everyone mm-hmm. is blind.
Yep.
Everybody blind, and that's the problem with conflicts, war conflicts between regions, but also conflicts between supporters. They've been wrong before, and then they do wrong, and then the cycle moves on and on and on. It leaves everybody blind.
So, that being said, from your explanation earlier, can we just say now the football in Indonesia had become an industry? And so far, for your eyes in the industry, in your knowledge, in sporting events, according to FIFA, those stewards and everyone related to a sporting event needs to be trained. And in your knowledge, has there been any training for related parties and sporting events in Indonesia?
Yeah, of course. I mean, you know, PT Liga Indonesia, I mean, there is even called Baru, PT Liga Indonesia Baru. Mm-hmm. They obviously have their standards, and sometimes the, like a lot of things in Indonesia, the working together, the coherence, the cohesion, the, you know, the teamwork between different departments don't work really well. Or, you know, I believe, you know, lack of new technology, for example, that are used in Europe could help. I mean, it's hurting us as well. I mean, that's something that could be looked at as a solution. Maybe that would help. But, you know, I'm not an expert of crowd control and things like that. But the point is, it has happened all over the world.
Yeah.
And the difference between countries is not that one country it doesn't happen, in another country it happens. That's not the difference. Because I believe the sinful nature of human is everywhere. It's globalized. So, you know, it just, bad things happen. Bad people are everywhere. You know, there are silly people and there are wise people everywhere in the world. So that's not the difference between countries. But the difference is how they take care of the problem. Mm-hmm. And so you can see that European countries or modern countries, this doesn't happen much anymore. Or, you know, it has been controlled completely. So that's something that Indonesia has to look at, you know, how does the modern country use technology, and mm-hmm. what can we do with the prevention side of things, mm-hmm. And what can we do with the care side of things when something does happen. So not just thinking, oh, you know, nothing will happen. You know, as in, you know, this stadium is so full of Arema fans, and we will win today. But you know, obviously they could win or they could lose, mm-hmm. you know, at home. So, and if they do lose against Surabaya, the one club they're not supposed to lose against, you know, then the bad things will happen. So that doesn't take a genius to mm-hmm. predict.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why I said in the prevention side of things, a lot of mistakes were done, or not enough prevention was made. And then the fatal mistake is using the gas, the tear gas, as a way of crowd control. Do that elsewhere in the middle of the city, fine, but not in a confined area like a stadium. And then sending it out to the stands, you know, whether it's directly to the stands or indirectly, but you know their stands, and the people on the stands are not the ones coming in. Mm-hmm. They're not the ones causing the problem, right?
Yeah.
So you're supposed to take care of the problem with the people on the pitch. The people on the stands are not doing anything, and they're the ones that got killed because of the stampede, right? And so it's so tragic, right?
So, Coach Timo, I actually have one question. So, I am in sports governance, and I govern rugby, and there are instances in rugby, international rugby, or even local rugby and league, that usually the team gets penalized or gets a sanction, whoever's team's fans are the ones, you know, causing the issue. Does this happen in football as well? I'm not familiar with the rules, but I have heard, you know, internationally, I think it was Senegal with somebody with a laser, mm-hmm. that was an instance, and they had a penalty and a fee. Do you think that that this team, whose fans were at fault, would be, you know, would get penalized or sanctioned in one way or another because of this incident?
Obviously, there's, you know, the head of the federation, Iwan, already said that Arema cannot hold home games anymore for the rest of the season, and there will be other sanctions coming, because usually there's money sanctions and you know, a sanction with a game without supporters, or you know, you have to play away, and in this case they cannot play at home anymore, they have to play elsewhere. So it's not just they don't have supporters, they have to play away from Malang, and you know, the there are incidents also where, you know, there are rules, and so you can get points off, get money, money kind of sanctions, and all kinds of other sanctions. So they have rules about that, and they're okay. It's just, I don't, you know, I mean, it's not preventing these things, because these things are happening again and again. So that's not the cure. You know, and so we have to look at the alternatives, because obviously the rules are not deterring these things from happening. Like I said before, this is not the first time. Maybe a lot of people watching thinking, oh, this is the first time. Oh, what a tragedy. No, this is a double tragedy, because it's such a big tragedy. And secondly, because it has happened over and over again. It's sort of like the mass shooting in America. You know, with the controversy of gun control, and everyone says condolences, pray for this school, pray for that school, and then the next school shooting happened again. And this is what happens in Indonesian stadiums. There's so many people that have died from watching football, and this has happened again and again. And so that's a tragedy in itself, that it happens again and again.
Okay.
And that it's not taken care of serious as it should be.
All right, Coach Timo, before we conclude our conversation, the last one for me. Our national team are doing good so far. How far this tragedy will affect the performance?
I don't think so. It won't affect their performance at all. I don't think so at all, except of course if we get banned from FIFA, which I'm not sure. Yeah, I'm not sure what kind of sanctions will come from FIFA, but some kind of sanction I'm sure will be bestowed upon us. But what kind? I cannot say right now. But if we get banned, definitely a huge loss, because we're going to host World Cup 20 under 20, and they're doing well.
Mm-hmm.
They're a bunch of good kids that, you know, have a good chance in that World Cup, and we're in the World Cup, even though it's not the senior World Cup, but at least we're in the World Cup and we're hosting it. So it's such an honor, and would be such a shame if this would affect them.
Yeah.
As in, they can't participate. And also the senior team, obviously, because they're doing so well at the moment. So that wouldn't be good at all.
Mm. All right, Coach Timo, thank you so much for joining us back in the program. And also, we'll be in touch very soon as the updates keep rolling in this tragedy. Coach Timo, thank you so much. Take care.
Thank you for having me.